Okay, let's now talk about the second subcategory of machine learning. And of course, it also implies it's a subcategory of deep learning. So this is unsupervised learning, which in contrast to supervised learning, does not use any labels or targets. So we don't have any feedback here, and it's more about finding a hidden structure in the data. So in that sense, we can also think of unsupervised learning as representation learning, and this is sometimes also used for dimensionality reduction. It doesn't have to be used for dimensionality reduction, but it's one application of it. So you probably have heard of principal component analysis in other statistics classes, or short PCA, which is a linear transformation technique that rotates the data and then extracts a linear combination of the inputs. So if you consider this example here, there are two features, feature one and feature two. These are our inputs, and here these circles are our data points in this space. And with principal component analysis, we find the eigenvectors of this data set. So in that way, we use these eigenvectors to rotate the data. So we have these two principal components. These are essentially eigenvectors. And usually we sort them by decreasing order so that we sort them by the eigenvalues, by the corresponding eigenvalues. So we usually keep the large eigenvalues or the eigenvectors corresponding to the large eigenvalues. So in this case, the eigenvalue corresponding to the first principal component is larger than the second one. So in a practical application, we may use this first principal component to have a compressed representation of our data. But this is a little bit more detail than we need to know. I just wanted to show you an example of unsupervised learning. If you don't know how PCA works, no worries about that. It's just, if you know it, this is a nice example of unsupervised learning. Another example of unsupervised learning are autoencoders, and this is something we will be talking in part 5 of this course. So this will be the first lecture in part 5, generative deep learning. So autoencoders work like this. It's actually a very simple concept. You have input data, so this is your input data, and then you have the output produced by the autoencoder. And the autoencoder consists of two parts, an encoder and a decoder. And first, the dimensionality of the input is very large, and then through hidden layers, there are that's a learned representation that is smaller dimensional, so we call that also the latent representation or feature embedding. This is let's say low dimensional, and this is high dimensional. So you can think of each pixel in the image as a feature. So if we have, let's say, 100 times 100 pixels, we have 100,000 features as input. So in that way, it's a very high dimensional input, and then you can maybe make this, like, I don't know, 10 dimensional. It really depends on the data set, but let's say we make this 10 dimensional. This is learned by the encoder, it's a neural network, and then we have a decoder which undoes that. It's basically the opposite, taking the low dimensional input and making the high dimensional, let's say the 100,000 dimensional, output. So the goal here is reconstructing the input. So why would we be interested in that? So why is that a useful exercise? What's the point of this autoencoder if it's just learning how to reconstruct the input? So the goal is basically, or the interesting part is, this latent representation. So you can think of this as a compressed version of your data. So if the decoder is able to reconstruct the original image from this small dimension, it means that this dimensionality here is sufficient to encode important information about the data. So it's you can think of it as a compressed version of the data. So in that way, it's also dimensionality reduction. There's actually a close relationship between an autoencoder and principal component analysis if the autoencoder consists of linear activations. But don't worry about this detail. We will be talking about autoencoders more in part 5. It's just another example of unsupervised learning here. And just, yeah, for reference, because I already had this nice cat picture, again, how classification works. This is the majority of deep learning is about classification. So consider we have an input data point here. It's this cat image. And during training, we have a label that's a cat here. And then the network produces a probability, the probability that this image is a cat. And then we can give it a new data. It could be a dog or a cat. And basically everything, anything, and then it would produce a probability, how likely is it to belong to the class cat, for example. So a classifier is classifying the images, what label they have, whereas unsupervised learning is really very different. It's not about predicting any labels here, it's about learning this hidden representation that can be used then to reconstruct the input. Okay, so this was one example of unsupervised learning, the dimensionality reduction or representation learning. Another example of unsupervised learning is clustering. You've probably heard of clustering before. It's assigning a group membership to unlabeled examples. So here, let's consider a data set where I have, again, two features, x1 and x2. I don't have any class labels. I'm just grouping them by similarity. And just by looking at it, you can think of these points here, because they are closer together, that they may belong to a cluster, and these belong to a cluster, and so forth. Here, it's kind of obvious what belongs to a cluster. In real life, cluster boundaries are sometimes not so clear. It's also usually high dimensionality. So usually, clustering is about finding group memberships. So, but here the difference again to classification is that we don't know the true labels. So we can also say this could maybe be one cluster and this could be one cluster. There are some measures for measuring cluster quality, like intrinsic measures, but we don't have like a real true answer here. Also, clustering, I'm just mentioning it here, but it also won't play a role in this course, so we won't be talking about clustering in this class. It's really not the goal of this class here. It's more like a data mining topic, I would say. All right, in the next video, let me briefly talk about reinforcement learning.